by addressing these issues so that the outcome is a successful one. And the further what I'm going to discuss is how the conservation social sciences help us to analyze some of them and how they will help us to understand the complex socio-ecological relationships and what are the tools available for us to understand these complexities and to find out what are the possible solutions to these issues. So these are the main things which I'm going to cover in my presentation. So let us start with what are the conservation efforts in India and what are the, in brief actually, I'm not going to the details, and then highlight what are some of the problems that we face. I'll take an example, one particular example of human-animal conflict, and then try to highlight some of the social issues involved in addressing them, and then go to the social science in general, you know, what are the issues in any conservation, not just in wildlife conservation, but in any kinds of conservation efforts, what are the challenges we face and how social sciences as a discipline or a conservation social science in particular as a discipline can help us to understand and scientifically try to come up with some solution or solutions to the problem. So let us start with the history of biodiversity conservation in India. So most of you will be knowing that the India has a long history of biodiversity conservation or wildlife conservation. And in fact, it dates back to the colonial period. So if you see some of the, and these are reflected in various types of, you know, enactments of various acts, etc. So some of the first few acts aimed at wildlife conservation, either directly or indirectly, is a Wild Birds Protection Act of 1887. Then came the Wildlife, Birds and Animals Protection Act of 1887, which was amended subsequently different times. And then there was the Wildlife Protection Act of 1927, etc. So from the colonial period or the pre-independence period itself, we can see that there have been concerted efforts for the conservation of wildlife in India. But the most comprehensive act since independence was the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And this act accorded varying degrees of protection to a range of animal species and their habitat. And this act also enabled the setting up of national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, etc. And in fact, this act was also have been amended few times. And under this act, you know, different projects were taken up to protect the species and her habitat. It includes a Project Tiger, which was initiated in 1970, and then the Project Elephant in 1992. Both were flagship species, you know, programs, you know, directed at conserving the species and habitat. Besides this, India is also a member of several international conservation treaties, and it has also international commitment to protect its ecosystems and habitats and animals and wildlife or biodiversity. The Ramsar Convention of 1971, it is a convention, international convention of wetlands in India, is also a signatory to that, and it has a commitment to protect the wetlands and other water bodies. Then it is also a signatory in the Convention on International Trade and Endangered Species of Wildlife, Fauna and Flora, and it was enacted, it joined in 1973. Then there are also other, you know, India is also signatory in other conventions like Convention of Migratory Species in 1979, Convention on Biological Diversity in 1992. All this point out to the fact that India is seriously involved or engaged in the conservation of its biodiversity, natural environment and ecosystems. So if you look at the current status, it's a rough idea, like we have about 40 tiger reserves, nearly 30 elephant reserves, and we have a protected area of 668 protected area network we have. So according to this, the kind of, you know, protected areas, for example, national parks have been given higher level of protection with no human contact or human intervention like grazing or ownership of private land holding, etc. is permitted within them. And then there are sanctuaries, you know, sanctuaries are given a lesser level of protection with certain activities being permitted inside of sanctuaries. And there are also a very powerful law enacted. It is called as the Environment Protection Act of 1986. As that act also makes serious efforts to protect wildlife habitats and wildlife power laws and in the environment in general in India. But despite this, what we see is that our environment and natural resources are not sufficiently, you know, in good shape or protected. So one of the reasons, major, you know, reasons or argument put forth is that the population pressure and development needs of the country is exerting a lot of pressure on its natural resources. As you know, India is one of the most populous countries in the world, maybe after China, and the population, most of the population is living below poverty line or are not very rich. And the country's development, infrastructure development is not up to the expected level, or it's still lagging behind different, behind other countries. So we have a lot of, you know, pressures to use the natural resources, and the population is still growing. So all these are putting severe pressure on our natural resources. And all these are resulting in the clearance of natural areas, including forests, wetlands, and etc. for other developmental projects and other land uses. And then we also witnessed in a large scale deforestation, which is basically due to the conversion of forest areas and other natural habitats for various other non-forest or agricultural or development purposes, etc. So we are witnessing a competition for the resource for development. So if you look at this in one particular lens, that one particular way, that all these are a positive signs that, like, you know, our we are growing economy, we are growing and developing. So if you if one of the group of people argue that, okay, these are all signs of development and we should be welcoming it, but there is also other argument that these are not good signs of development. Why? These developments are not sustainable because we are eroding the natural resource base, and this natural resource base is the basis for the welfare of our future, present as well as future generations. So there is thus a serious concern about the protection or conservation of natural resources, including plant and animal biodiversity. As a result, we always see a tension between environmental protection and development. So in terms of wildlife, we see that there are a lot of illegal killing and trade of wildlife, poaching, etc. We see the rhino poaching, elephant poaching, and different kinds of, you know, threats to the animals. And then we see that because of land conversion, forest getting fragmented, and many animals dying or killed during killed in the road accidents, even inside the forest. And it's not only pertaining to the terrestrial animals, it is also applicable to the oceanic and water animals, including the olive ridleys, etc. Studies have pointed out that due to uncontrolled trawling operations, olive ridleys are killed in large numbers every year. So these are some of the things which we notice, that, like, there is a cost for development. We are developing, but at what cost, and how our wildlife and biodiversity are protected? So are we, like, protecting enough our rich biodiversity? That's the question. So there is a recognition that an integrated approach, by an integrated approach we mean that there should be an interconnected, we should understand the interconnectedness between social and ecological system. One is a social system, one we say that the humans are there, and humans and their development activities. And then there is an ecological system where the nature comes. So we should have understand the interconnections and the interconnections between both of them to have a sustainable, you know, development. So when it comes to the social aspect, we mean that we have to understand the human dimensions of conservation. Only when we understand the human aspects of conservation, we will be able to come up with effective policies, actions, which can result in positive outcomes. Here, there is a need to integrate both natural sciences and social sciences, which is the crux of the argument and crux of the presentation. But so far so good, you know, it is well easy to say this, but how difficult is to implement it? So Difficulties in understanding and incorporating the social and ecological dimensions arises because of the complexities involved in the relationship itself. For example, you say that India is a poor country, it is a developing country. And in this country, developing country, a large number of poor and the rural people depend upon natural resources for their livelihoods. And they are actually constrained by resources. They need to have their livelihood, and so many people depend upon natural resources. And once the conservation efforts are brought in and people are restricted from accessing these resources, it results in a tension. So not only in India, in most developing countries, people are natural resource dependent for their livelihood to a large extent. So that is the cause of all this confusion, tension and conflict between. So on the one side, there is a conservation need. We know that our biodiversity is threatened. We need to protect the biodiversity, including both plant and animal biodiversity. But the other side, we have a large extent of poverty existing in our country, and we also need to provide livelihoods for the large sections of the people. So restriction on local communities for accessing natural resources might affect the motivation of people for conservation. So if you are going to implement a restriction or a control on the access of resources, for example, you take the forest area. If a national park is created and the people are prevented from entering into the national park for collecting NTFPs, non-timber forest products, it might be affecting the livelihood of the local community who have been depending on those resources for since a time immemorial for their livelihood. So what happens here is that they will not be interested in any conservation efforts because their livelihood is threatened. So there is a reason for the tension, you know, there is a tension arising there because local communities are deprived of their rights to the natural resources. Consider here as a forest or a river or, you know, any other resource. And then on the other hand, if you are pursuing economic development, you know, if the government or if the state is only concerned about economic development and it is pushing economic development by all means without any concern for ecosystem, it may affect the ecological resources, including all plant and animal diversity. So the problem here is that we will be eroding our base, natural resource base, and that kind of development cannot be sustained. Then there are also other reasons and implications for these conflicts. The conflict between, you know, conservation and livelihood, that is a conflict here I'm talking about. One is the conservation needs and the other is the development or livelihoods need. So these conflicts can also result in unbalanced and inadequate development in some parts of the region. So, you know, if you see the India as a country, we can see that there are certain regions that are better endowed in natural resources. For example, you take the example of forest. There are some regions which have very rich forest. But when we plot the poverty of those regions, we see a kind of peculiar relationship that wherever the resources are very high, natural resources are very high, the availability is very high, in those places, the poverty levels are also very high. So naturally, normally we expect that if the region is resource rich, the development must be more and the people should be well off or their welfare should be better than the other regions. So there is something called a resource curse theory. It is like, you know, it tries to explain why that happens, you know. Wherever the resources are rich, people are poor. This is a kind of contradiction. So these kinds of tension between livelihood and conservation can lead to a kind of unbalanced development. And this kind of unbalanced development is also not very favorable for the overall economic growth and development of the country, as well as it has also a large number of equity implications, the equitable distribution of wealth. You know, there are lots of equity implications implied in equity implications in that. So we cannot have or, you know, advocate this kind of unbalanced development. So what is the challenge? So the challenge is to find or an find out or and achieve a balance and positive feedback from between ecological conservation and economic development. So there must be a fine balance between our need for the conservation of the resources, including wildlife and other natural resources, as well as economic development. So going or pushing forward for either one of these is not going to help. There will be problems if you are adopting such a path. So it is here that the understanding of social factors which affect or determine people's relation with nature and natural resource becomes essential. Because how do you decide, you know, what kind of, you know, conservation measures we should be adopt? What kind of conservation efforts or conservation strategies are feasible in a particular location without compromising the local people's need for economic and social development? So that is a real challenge. But we can say that in theory or in principle, we can say that we must have the balance between conservation and economic development. But how we are going to put that in practice, that is the most challenging thing when it comes to the human and the social relationship of between natural resources. So what are some of the social and economic issues associated with conservation? When I talk here about conservation, it also implies our need for development also. So conservation alone cannot help. So we have to also balance the need for conservation and our need for development. So some of the specific questions which we can ask in this context is, who are the people that are affected by conservation policies and programs? Suppose you take the example of establishment of a national park. So suppose some area is notified as a national park. So the question immediately arises in the minds of a social scientist would be like, who are the people affected by that policy and how they are impacted, you know? So what are the ways in which the people are impacted by a particular conservation policy? How understanding of the local people's use of natural resources enhance planning of land use and minimize conflicts? So once you know that, you know, how they are going to be impacted, then we need to know how and what are the ways in which they are going to be impacted and what are the reasons why they are impacted. So that could be historical, cultural, social and other economic aspects. So, and then the question is, what are the costs and benefits involved? If suppose a policy is implemented, suppose a national park is implemented or a project is implemented there. You take the example of the proposed hydroelectric project of Adrapalli. So Adrapalli project, suppose if it is implemented, it results in the lots of forest areas and the species, everything will be getting affected. So the question is, how do you judge whether we need to go with that kind of development or not? From the economics point of view, the decision will be taken based on a cost-benefit analysis. So the economist or an environmental economist will try to quantify what are the costs, various costs and benefits involved in it, and what are the trade-offs involved in implementing that project. And finally, who benefits and what is the extent of benefit, all that will determine whether the project should go ahead or not. So this quantification is also not very easy because there will be those who are directly benefited, those will be benefited and affected negatively. And also the problem is that all the effect will not be happening at the same point of time. Some of the effects will be visible or some of the effects will be appearing after a long period of time or after a few years. So how do you really account for those changes in the ecosystem which is going to happen in the future? So all these things, you know, if you try to measure and understand it, we understand that the issue is becoming more and more complex. Then there is a question of equity and justice. So suppose with the hydroelectric dam, who is going to benefit from the establishment of that dam? Vis-a-vis, who is going to be affected by the cost or who is bearing the cost? Cost in the sense it is not just the financial cost. suppose, you know, somebody losing their, you know, homes, it is a cost incurred by them. You know, we call it as a cost. So it need not be in monetary terms alone. Non-monetary terms also, the losses have to be accounted and, you know, before we take a distribution. Then the question is how this cost and benefits are distributed, whether it is equitably distributed or not. Maybe the local communities will have to suffer all the losses and their benefits due to that project could be very nil, very almost negligible, whereas the public at large may be benefiting. So the question is it justifiable to go with that kind of development projects or not, which will adversely affect the biodiversity, both animal and plant biodiversity. So these are the questions, you know, which will bother us, you know, when we go ahead with this kind of conservation versus development dilemma. Then we already are able to understand that there are people who are going to gain and as well as people who are going to lose, and that stakeholders, we call them as stakeholders, need not be individuals alone. It can be like individuals, community level, anyone, it could be anyone. And then the question is whether there is any mechanism that exists to compensate the losses for their losses they suffer. Okay, we have already found out that there will be losses. There is one argument saying that in every project there will be some losers and gainers. So whether the gainers will be able to compensate the losses for the losses they suffer, whether that is possible at all, that is the first question. And then the question comes, if it is possible to compensate the losses, and how are we going to compensate them? What kind of mechanisms will be adopted to compensate them so that, like, you know, their support for conservation is ensured? And what kind of governance system we have, whether we have a decentralized governance system or kind of a top-down approach, etc., whether any role for the local communities are in there in that governance, etc., comes up. So these are some of the complexities when we look into the issue of conservation versus development. Let me take one example of, so far I've been talking about the specific general thing of the conservation versus development dilemma and the issues involved in that. And let me now come to a specific context of human-animal conflict and try to understand what are the challenges, you know, from the social science perspective when we talk about, you know, finding a solution for the human-animal conflict. So please note that, you know, I'm not going to suggest any remedies or measures to resolve this conflict. The point is to highlight the challenges involved in coming up with a solution. And this solution cannot be a generic one. Whatever solutions adopted for the human-animal conflict, or for that matter, any environmental resource, it cannot be a generic one. It has to be dependent on the context. The context is very important, and detailed study about the context is necessary to take appropriate measures. So let us come to the human-animal conflict. So as I mentioned earlier, the increasing human population and animal population, together with the shrinking of forest or natural habitats, these kinds of conflicts are becoming inevitable. So as human population grows, forest covers are shrinking, humans and animals, they start to compete and jostle for the same limited resources. That is the whole reason why this conflict emerges. So if you recall the newspaper reports, every other day we get to read some human-animal conflict or the other reported from different parts of India. So one of the major media covered, one of the major incidents which covered a lot of media attention was the killing of tigress Avni in 2008. This was a tigress that killed about 13 human beings and was shot dead in Maharashtra. And there was an outpouring of grief, anger and protest from several quarters. So this has caught the attention of most people, like the incident, like why this animal was killed at all. And then we hear every other day, we hear the elephants being electrocuted and the railway accidents, killing animals in the different states in India, especially the northeastern states, Orissa, etc. And revenge killing of animals by humans also are reported. So according to the Environment Ministry, Ministry of Environment and Climate Change, they have reported that more than 1,600 human beings were killed between 2014 and 17 due to this conflict alone. And there could be a large number of unreported cases as well. So this is amounting to, like, you know, averaging of one or more human being every day during those 3 year period. So this is quite substantial. So most of these, you know, deaths have been occurred by, or the killing has been by the tiger, elephant, then snakes, leopards, bears, etc. But the fact is that we don't have proper governmental data to show how the extent of deaths of animals due to human-animal conflict. So we have some number of, you know, human beings being killed due to the attack by wild animals, but we don't have enough reliable data to say how many animals have been killed or died due to the conflict. So the question is why the conflict occurs. We said that the humans and animals, they have to compete for the limited amount of resources available. So how and when does the conflict occur? Human-wildlife conflict occurs when animals pose a direct and recurring threat to the livelihood or safety of people, leading to the persecution of that species. So this is what, you know, the literature says, what is human-wildlife conflict? They say that it occurs when animals pose a direct and recurring threat. It is not only direct, it is a recurring, it is a repeating threat to the livelihood or safety of people. And that threat, you know, finally leads to the persecution of that species by humans. And then there are also retaliation against the species blamed, often ensues and leading to conflict, and what should be done to remedy the situation. So the retaliation happens and everything happens and the conflict situation emerges. So it occurs when growing human population overlap with established wildlife territories. That is a major problem. You know, the growing population have been encroaching the habitat of animals. The human population has been encroaching forest areas and their territories. So this causes a chance for increased interaction of man, humans and the wild animals, and thus results in increased levels of conflict. Direct contact with wildlife occurs in both urban and rural areas. So one should not be under an impression that this occurs only in the rural areas, but this kind of conflicts occurs also in the urban areas. Movement and ranging patterns of large mammals are controlled by essentially availability of food, water, escape cover, and mates. So some of the reasons, you know, why the animals move are they go in search for availability of food, water, or escape, or finding out mates, etc. Unavailability of any of these components in natural habitats forces wild animals to move out, causing several forms of conflict. So here the point is that we already know that the animals may be moving due to these so-called reasons. They will be looking for availability of food or water or mates or escape cover. But we often forget what was the reason for them to face these kinds of situation, that we are not at all aware, or not we are not concerned about it. It is basically, it could be the human interventions or in human interaction inside their habitat that has led to the all the above crisis, or the shortage of food, water, escape, etc. Because humans have reduced their habitat, extent of their habitat, they have encroached their water sources for other, you know, development projects, etc. And finally, they don't have enough of them to for their survival. So they move out in search of food, water, and other things. So what will be the consequence of, so the conflict emerges, and once the conflict emerges, what are the likely consequences? So to understand that, we also need to look into the relationship between humans and wildlife. So it is not a very direct relationship, you know, it is not an instantly formed relationship. It could be having several historical reasons, cultural reasons, how this relationship between humans and wildlife has emerged. And another point to remember here is that it is not only human and wildlife conflict. this human wildlife conflict can also involve human human conflict. You see, if there are different stakeholders or different communities in a locality, the conflict can lead to a human wildlife conflict can lead to a conflict between the different communities of people living in the periphery of the forest, etc. Because everybody is perceiving threat from the wildlife, their livelihoods is affected, their property or assets are affected, and that could lead to the conflict among themselves. So, and these kinds of conservation conflicts are widespread and are damaging for biodiversity, livelihoods, and human well-being. It is not just the wild animals are affected by these kinds of conflicts. It is a larger threat affecting the larger biodiversity, the livelihoods, and human well-being. People lose their crops, livestock, property, and sometimes their lives. And the animals, many of which are already threatened or endangered, are often killed in retaliation or to prevent future conflicts. That is a human response to these kinds of conflict. You know, they may kill animals in retaliation for this and to avoid future conflicts. But let us, look into how, the relationship, the human-animal interactions have evolved. So literature says that the human-animal interactions is very old, and that can be positive or negative. So the literature again states that Homo sapiens have competed with other species for habitat and resources all along the history. And they have innovated and adapted to become the dominant ecological force on the earth. So if you look at the journey of the Homo sapiens, the human beings, we can always see that they have always interacted with wild animals. So they have, tried to adapted, innovated, and adapted. And in the process of becoming the most dominant species on earth, they have entered into different kinds of conflicts, and as a result, many of the species have got extinct. And humans also have, domesticated many animals in the process. So all this have happened in the past. All these have also resulted in the immeasurable loss of human life, crops, livestock, and property. So the key point is that how we try to mitigate this conflict. And the way in which we try to mitigate this conflict is central to the conservation and even the restoration of many species, including the endangered species. A major challenge of modern conservation is how to balance the protection of endangered species with the needs of human communities while meeting the needs of the human community so that there is no conflict between the humans and wildlife. That is a major, challenge of conservation. And this form of the challenge, it could be different in different countries and different contexts. In countries where livelihood is not a major concern, people are not depending on natural resources for livelihood, this kind of conflict is of lesser significance. But whereas in countries like India, where the local people depend upon the forest and other natural resources for their livelihood, the significance is huge. So why does this happen like this? Why does the conflict emerge and what are its manifestations? Why people are getting so much worried? So here comes the concept of risk. When we perceive some risk, when we perceive a danger, we behave in a particular manner. So humans, when they perceive risk due to wildlife, their behavior will be different, and it varies. The kind of behavior adopted by humans varies according to the perception of risk, the degree of the risk they perceive, and how, what are the options or the what kind of responses they can adopt. Often the problem is that there is a considerable mismatch between all of them. See. Sometimes, there may not be any real risk, but the people will be perceiving a higher risk than what actually exists. And their response also will be guided by the amount or the gravity of the risk they feel. And how the risks are formed, how the human beings perceive the risk, it depends upon the context. See, certain kinds of cultural practices, cultural histories, ideologies, etc., can influence the people how they perceive risk. For example, some of the communities living inside the forest, they may be able to better deal with the risk of wildlife than somebody who is going from an urban area and watching the wildlife. So they know that, you know, the culturally and historically, they know how to interact with the animals. And, you know, they don't perceive as much risk. I can give you another small example, which we always, you know, see in the normal situations. For example, if you see a snake, people who are visiting or who are visiting a rural area from the urban areas, they get more frightened by seeing a normal snake, a rat snake or any kind of, you know, poisonous snake, than who have been living and growing with that kind of environment. So it is upon how kind of, you know, culturally developed and what kind of background you are coming from, you perceive the risk of snake. The snake is the same, but the persons who perceive the risk are different. You know, the type of risk different persons perceive is different. So in the studies point out that people perceive risk or the threat from large and visibly potential dangerous animals. See, actually the literature says that the human and human-animal interaction, the risk is a kind of a continuum. It is from negative to positive, actually. The impact of animals, you know, risky animals, it is a continuum from negative to positive. But the human tendency is to, like, if the animal is a large species, we perceive it as a more dangerous one than a rodent. For example, a rodent can be doing more harm for the crops of farmers, for example, rather than an elephant. But farmers, you know, will perceive the damage or the threat from the elephant as much higher than the threat from a rodent. So it is how the risks are perceived by different people. And here the media also have a role to form the public's opinion. You know, how the media, both visual and electronic media, how they frame the conflict and how they present it before the public, that also shape the risk that people perceive. Then another factor which influences the risk perception is education. So education may encourage a behavior that reduces the risk or conflict. If you are more educated, if you are more aware of the characteristics of the animal or the kind of natural resources, you are less likely to feel threatened. And then there are, like, you know, measures like the enforcement of rules and regulations, you know, that can reduce the risk perception. If proper rules and regulations are implemented, then people will be more comfortable seeing wildlife, etc. So here the point is that how communities come together and work together to address the risk and reduce conflict is very important. So the behavior is, you know, shaped by a number of social and other cultural factors, and these all influence the perception of the people, and the perception of the people ultimately lead them to a kind of behavior that can be, like, you know, destructive for the conservation of animals, or, you know, conducive for the helpful for the conservation of animals. So there are some mediating variables like education, awareness creation, etc., that can change the attitude or behavior of the humans positively for conservation efforts. But then this is not easy, actually. There are several, you know, complexities involved here. One is the problem with the scale. Scale means there are different extents, like local, global, state level or national level and global level issues. Some of the issues can be addressed right at the local level, whereas some problems cannot be attended at the local level. For example, a broader policy for biodiversity conservation. Perhaps it has to be done at the international level, some commitments, and then it has to come through legislation, national legislation, and then come to the local level, you know, what kind of conservation efforts can be implemented. So there will be always a mismatch between what is happening at the local level and what is being reflected at the national and international levels. As I said, there could be some reasons for people to behave the way they behave. And also, we have to bear in mind that the conflicts, the mitigation of conflicts becomes more complex in areas where resource dependence of humans is very high, poverty is very high, and education levels are very low. So when the poverty is very high, people have to depend on the natural resources around them for their survival. So if the animals are also coming into that sphere, that space, definitely the conflict is going to happen. People always, you know, weigh their livelihood over any other kind of conservation. And also it has to be, we have to note that people value their present more important as more important their future welfare. The present welfare is more important for them. To meet the needs of the present is more important than people think that they have to meet some needs in their future. And then there are also other complexities in terms of gender, you know. There are also gender differences, not only in the way women and men interact with the environment, but also the way they perceive risk and approach conflict. So one example is in Uttarakhand, the crop raiding by elephants. Due to crop raiding by elephants, women are more affected because their food security is affected. So they have a different kind of attitude toward conservation than the men, because they are mostly they are food producers, and if their food security is affected, and they are not definitely going to favor the conservation because they consider the elephants or the animals as a threat to their livelihood, and they will be all for retaliation or, you know, killing of the animal, or, you know, whatever way you can control the entry of animals into their livelihood area or sphere. So when we look into the kind of management, the human wildlife management, the conflicts are managed through managing the wildlife and through managing the humans. So managing wildlife is through the one method is that lethal control, because, you know, they use firearms or poison, and mostly to eradicate the animal or kill the animal. And this is a very controversial method. And the preferable method is the other one, you know, non-lethal method control. It includes translocation of wildlife, which involves moving wildlife away from the conflict locations, or in a construction of barriers or exclusionary devices which reduce the wildlife damage, or, you know, prevent entry of animals into the human sphere or human space. And even it includes providing alternative food sources to divert animals damaging the crops, etc. Of this, you know, guarding and restraint is considered as one of the oldest and most successful methods. So this is one way of managing the conflicts, that is managing the wildlife itself, and you manage the conflict. The other, you know, other part is managing the humans, you know, how we control the human activities which is causing the wildlife attacks or wildlife conflicts. So that involves, you know, we have to change the human behavior, the human perception about the threats to wildlife. And for to do that, we will have to adopt a number of measures, policy measures, which includes good governance and public policy, spatial zoning, and even use of economic incentives. Like, you know, if somebody is affected by the crop damage, you know, due to wildlife attack, so try to design a mechanism for compensating them or providing insurance to them. So all these will change the perception or the tolerance level of the people affected towards wildlife. So, but, you know, how do you decide which approach will be more suitable, and to what extent we have to adopt managing wildlife and managing humans to resolve the wildlife, human wildlife conflict? So that is not an easily answerable question, and it depends upon the context, and a lot of, you know, efforts have to be made to understand the context in which the conflicts have been emerging or emerged, and how it happens, and who are the stakeholders involved in it, and how they are affected, and what are the gains that they are going to get by controlling or resolving the conflicts, etc. So if you want to study that, here comes the relevance of social science. We have to use a number of social science research methods to understand the various dimensions, the social dimensions. I've been mentioning about social dimensions, the cultural context and other social behavior of human beings, etc. So if you want to, this is a general statement saying that, you know, we have to understand the economic aspects, either social aspects, cultural aspects, but how do you do them? Like, you know, if you have to do them properly, we need to have a scientific approach using the social sciences methods. So actually in the literature, if you see the human animal conflict, a wide range of approaches are used to deal with it, including the education and information sharing, co-management. Co-management means communities and the government agencies work together to resolve the conflict, etc. So there are many types of approaches, but how would you decide what approach suits in what context? That involves a detailed analysis of the context itself. So I will go to the relevance in how social science can help us in achieving this. I'll be talking in the rest of my presentation. But let me also say that why we are so much worried about the social impact, by because already there are different attempts or approaches from the natural sciences, but why we are always concerned about the social impact. To put it briefly, it has both ethical and practical foundations. So these are the basic reasons why we should be concerned about the social impacts. Ethical dimension stems from the recognition of the rights of the local people to their resources. It is a means of subsistence for them, and there is a ethical, you know, duty for us to compensate for the losses. And it also rests on social justice and legal human rights framework, which are not necessarily linked to the conservation outcome. So there is an ethical reason why we should do certain things, and there is also a practical side of it. What is the practical side? The practical side stems from the linkages between social and conservation outcomes. So there will be both positive and negative outcomes. So the positive, we mean that the flow of positive benefits to people from natural resources enable and provide incentives for sustainable management over long term. So here what we are saying is that if the people perceive a positive benefit, that will act an incentive for them to, you know, collaborate with the conservation efforts. Whereas on the other hand, if the people are perceiving or experiencing negative impacts, that can erode. In that kind of circumstances, we will not be able to gain any local support for conservation, and the lack of cooperation from the community will make the conservation more difficult and less sustainable. So the complex, if you summarize the complex issue, so what are the problems related to conservation? Identification of the problems related to conservation itself is a major challenge, because some of the problems will not be visible on the locality or the spot. It could be appearing somewhere else at a different time point or time period of time. And once you identify the problems related to conservation, then it's necessary to understand the causes of the problem. And the causes also, then again, we have to go into detail about each and every cause and what are the reasons. And we have to try to understand, because these are all interlinked. So it is not very easy to understand or, you know, delineate one problem from the other. Then comes the whole question of, you know, how do you find a solution to this problem. See, these are all the complexities involved in trying to understand the social aspects of conservation. Here, the social sciences can help us in a major way to help us to scientifically understand the whole debate of the conservation issue. And they can provide unique and important contributions to society's understanding of the relationship between humans and nature, and to improve the conservation practices and outcomes. So what it says is that it can provide a more inclusive and integrative conservation science, which includes the natural and social sciences. Actually, there is a whole branch of social science that has emerged, which is termed as conservation social science. This conservation social science, it includes both natural and social sciences. And that will help us to find ways for more and effective, ecologically effective and socially just conservation. So how the social sciences as a discipline can help us? It can help us in answering a numerous question like the ones which we have seen before. And those questions addressing or trying to answer those questions can improve our understanding of conservation policy and practice. And this can happen from different levels, from individual to community to the international scale. In other words, social sciences or the social scientific way, methods of social sciences can help us in understanding what constitutes or determining what constitutes effective managing. Ultimately, the goal is to have an effective management and governance systems for conservation. So to identify itself, that itself actually what constitutes effective management, we are clueless, what constitute effective management. The scientific methods available in social sciences can help us to suggest the possible effective management regimes or systems and the strategies for conservation. In other words, the social sciences can provide a descriptive role. So it can give us an historical account of the ways in which conservation issues are addressed and they occur at different contexts. And then they can be used to answer some critical questions, like about the way different conservation models are framed and justified. See, it can help us to identify what conservation strategy is culturally appropriate and that can lead to a successful outcome. And there are also it can introduce new concepts of conservation and new policies, etc. So all these will come as an outcome or the outcome of the research we do from the social science perspective. And the advantage here of social science here is that it used to address and understand the issues at different scales. Here, different scales means those individuals who are directly engaged with the wildlife issues or conservation issues, to the local people who may or may not be directly involved in the conservation, to the state level, national level, and global level. So the stakeholders are spread across the world actually at different levels. So social sciences can help to draw inputs from them and design the policies which is most likely to result in positive and successful outcome. So at the global scale, the social science might be helping to us to give some ideas about the influences of international agreement. So for example, in biodiversity conservation, there are several international conventions and agreements which becomes international agreements and conventions wherein the signatory countries signing on it or have to be observing or following that. So that kind of international commitment is also good for the conservation efforts. And the local efforts are also equally important. So social science can help us to tell us what is needed at the global level, what is needed at the subnational level, what is needed at the national level, etc. So if we summarize the research or the social understanding of social issues at different levels, you can see that from the bottom there are local and individual level, and then there are national and subnational levels and global and regional levels. So each level is important and there is a necessity to take proper measures at each level for a successful conservation. So I'm not going into the details of this because it is slightly complicated. And where are we standing now? So we have already seen that there is an internationally recognized that natural sciences and social sciences have to come together if you have to have a successful conservation. So are we really moving towards that or still, where are we? So the experiences shows that there is an increased awareness about among the conservation agencies to involve social sciences in their design of conservation strategies and programs. And this is reflected in the number of social science researchers in many of the most reputed conservation organizations and the introduction of social science courses in conservation natural science curriculum. And even in the international, you know, organizations, the role of social science have been increasing. But yet social sciences have not the same level of attention and acceptance in the conservation sciences. And the reason for this is that it is very complex, and the role of social conservation, social science is often not clear to the conservation scientist, organization and practitioners. So it is still in an evolving stage, and therefore it has not become a major decision, major player in the decision making. So what are these fields? When I say that about social sciences, what do I exactly mean by the social sciences, conservation social sciences? So this field of conservation social sciences is a recently coined, maybe few years back coined term for the social sciences dealing with conservation. And it refers, you know, it includes the classical disciplines like anthropology, sociology, political science, economics, psychology, human geography, etc. These are all considered or classified as classic disciplines of social sciences. I don't know how many of you have heard of all these discipline names itself. Then there are applied disciplines like education, development studies, marketing, communication studies, and law. But where most of the studies are focused are in the subfields. The subfields are like, you know, environmental anthropology, environmental sociology, environmental economics, ecological economics, conservation psychology, environmental education, etc. And each discipline has its own language and research methods. And all this together will help us to understand the complexities involved in social and ecological linkages and the problems. So then there are the interdisciplinary fields, which include science and technology studies, conservation and development, human ecology, ethno-ecology, political ecology, etc. I'm not going to the details of what each subject focuses on. Just to give a few examples, you know, how anthropology, the environmental anthropology, what it will help us to understand in the social context. So environmental anthropology, it studies how culture mediates the relationship between human and social, human societies and their physical, biotic, built and cognitive environments. It is here in an anthropologist's job to explain the role of culture in the conservation. Then if you go to the environmental economist will be applying the neoclassical economic terms, basically the cost-benefit analysis, based on which they will try to assess the different costs and benefits of conservation and to try to analyze what are the trade-offs involved. So if you have to prioritize one conservation activities over the other, how do you take a decision? Here the environmental economist will have an answer, because they try to quantify the various benefits and costs of conservation and then try to put a monetary value to it. And then, you know, they assess it and say that, okay, this conservation strategy is more beneficial than the other one. So here comes the role of environmental economists. Then there are similar fields like environmental humanities. So that basically tries to adopt a transdisciplinary approach, and it draws from humanities, arts, everything, you know, and then try to focus on the human condition and what kind of action is driven. Then comes the political ecology. So power is a major thing in, you know, shaping the human environmental relation. Power means whether it is economic power, social power or political power. So the political ecology, if you use the lens of political ecology, we will be able to study how the process of power is shaping human environment relationship. So all these fields, I'm not going to the details one by one. All these different interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary fields help us to understand the complexity involved. So here, this figure summarizes how the social science discipline will help us to understand each one of the social issues involved in conservation. So we have seen that classical social sciences, which include sociology, anthropology, etc., and they help to understand, all of them help to understand different aspects like markets, how the markets behave. Like if you think about the coronavirus, It is said that it has it was emerged in the Chinese wildlife market. So, and the food habits, how the changing lifestyle help, you know, promotes trade in wildlife, you know, meat consumption, etc. We'll be able to analyze using these disciplinary perspectives. Then how we govern them, the politics of power, culture, and what kind of laws and regulations or, you know, command and control policies are required to deal with wildlife conservation issues. And what are the norms? Norms here means not only the formal, here we mean the social norms. What kind of social norms and informal and formal management mechanisms exist for managing natural resources? So how they can be utilized for the conservation, etc., can be explained using these social sciences. So including education, you know, education can create awareness, and then the media, visual media, print media, etc., how they can influence the people in changing their behavior or the preferences or perceptions, etc. So these are the many things which social sciences, you know, in some summary help us to answer. And these can be defined as, some of them are individual attributes which will help us to come up and analyze the individual qualities or attributes, and then what kind of processes are involved, social processes, and it also tries to explain the existing social phenomenon. So this is a summary of the various disciplines involved in trying to explain the social context of conservation. So from the figure itself, you can understand, or you can see that a whole lot of disciplines or sub-disciplines are involved in trying to understand the social issues, which in itself indicates the kind of complexities involved in understanding conservation, social aspects of conservation. So no one particular disciplinary perspective is sufficient to explain all the phenomena. So if you have to explain a phenomena or a context and come up with a proper conservation strategy, we will need to use a different lenses of different disciplinary perspectives and link it with the natural science to come up with an effective and successful outcome. And how do we look at them? You know, we so have seen that there are different disciplinary perspectives, but how we study them is another, you know, area which takes us to the research methods, social science research methods. And there are both qualitative and quantitative methods and participatory methods. I will just talk about the first three. Qualitative methods includes interviews between the stakeholder, with the stakeholders. It can have focus group discussions, participant observation or ethnographic study. Even photography and photo elicitation are all part of this. So if you interact with the communities that are affected and then understand their issues and concerns, and then how best we can include them in the conservation. So all that can be done through the qualitative research on social science research methods. Then when it comes to the valuation, if you want to have a proper cost-benefit analysis, then there are methods like surveys and economic valuation. Then participatory research or participatory action methods are there. So where, you know, communities are involved in at each and every stage of the design of conservation strategies and programs. So it is a mix of, you know, different methods and approaches that can lead to a design of proper policies and programs for conservation. And how we study is, there are different tools available and there are different disciplinary approaches available to study a particular phenomena. And then there are also different ways to disseminate the research results so that the behavior and the conservation efforts are successfully implemented. So this can be in the form of written articles or newspaper reports or facts and figures presenting the exact status of the conservation. And it could be the visual, you know, videographs and photographs, which many of you are involved in that, like presenting the status of conservation. Then there could be action research or experimental research, etc. So there are different ways of communicating this research properly for the betterment of the conservation efforts. So what is the way forward? You know, the way forward is like you have to try to integrate the social science approaches to the natural natural science approach for effective conservation, and to understand the social context and social phenomena is very important, and it's not a easy thing, and we'll have to use different disciplinary approaches to understand them, and we'll have to adopt a lot of, you know, different research methods simultaneously to understand a particular phenomena. And that is how, like, you know, the conservation can be more, you know, successful and effective. So with this, I thought this is what I wanted to speak to you. Thank you, and you know, please feel free to, you know, ask any clarifications, doubts, or anything. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Actually, we have had a small discussion on human-animal conflicts itself in our chat box. There was one question in the beginning from Dr. Rajiv sir about the difference between conservation and preservation. However, Isa sir has already replied to that. He has explained how preservation is basically just conservation without utilization.
Yes.
There have been some discussions about how there is a human-animal conflict in Nasik and human-human conflict, from what I understand, in Assam, in the Hing Patkai Reserve. And anyone else, if you have any questions, you can take this opportunity now. Isa sir, you would like to add to this?
Sir, you're on mute.
Yeah.
Isa sir, you can unmute.
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm sure that, you know, this is something new to most of us, because, you know, this, we have so that may be the problem. I think when Dina was mentioning about the human wildlife conflict, it was actually to give you an example of how social science can intervene in that and then go for a solution. That's why she has, at the end, you know, she has given the methodology that that could be applied. So interaction with the people and, you know, the different methods that could be used, you know, interviews and then participatory approach, all those things are there. As a part of this, I think you must be familiar with the eco-development part. Eco-development has been developed as a part of intervention through social science. So it is an outcome of social science. I'm sure that, you know, there is going to be a talk by Sanjay later. I think one of these days, you know, we will listen to him also. So I think, you know, the message is that the conservation is not just biology. It is also economics. And it is also the social science. It is also the anthropology. It is also different, and, you know, the humanities. So several aspects of these things. I think so. If you know more and more about it, you know, you will start allowing this relation between conservation and social aspects. I had the opportunity to work with her and her husband, you know, Dr. Jyotish, here in Kol as well as in LRK, Little Run of Kutch. Which is very, very interesting. Even now, I have written a new word has come, you know, resource curse theory. I have written that, and I'm going to read. I have already downloaded a literature on that. So likewise, you know, there is a lot to understand. It's not just conservation or just speaking about it, but understanding the various aspects of it. So I think that way, it was very good. It's only an introduction. Since it is not with the colorful slides and other things, you know, I'm sure people must have got an impression that, oh, this is a pure college lecture. But yes, it's to start with, it is like that only. But it is really interesting, you know, once you get into that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Isha sir, also for clarifying it. Yeah, basically, it was very good. It was excellent, because, like, that is something, like, you know, we sometimes forget also, because that's what Isa sir also pointed out about when we are talking about, like, the topic. So So yeah, so this is actually like very, very good topic for us, like to get starting with all our any conservation activities or any activities in future. Like, you know, we actually should understand like what is the value of humans, and as Jina Madam was mentioned, like the basically like the entire human history, like human development was kind of a human animal or the struggle with the nature. So some part of the world is still like is beyond that, like that they're developed, but then like some part of the world is still like struggling with it. So yeah, it was very good, very, very happy to understand, to get an understanding of it. Thank you, madam.
Ma'am, there was one question. If there is any new technique to solve the conflicts, human-animal conflicts, but I feel you can answer, ma'am.
Yeah, basically, there are many different techniques to understand. See, solution comes later. You know, first of all, mm-hmm. we have to understand the situation, the complexities involved. Mm-hmm. So, based on that, you know, people have to design strategies and programs for conservation. So the idea which I was trying to convey here is, as Dr. Isa said, it is not a presentation on human-wildlife mm-hmm. conflict as such. It was only taken as an example to show the complexities and where the social science understanding, the social science context, social context need to be understood. So I just wanted to highlight that as an example. And then otherwise, you know, if I talk about the social and economic aspects of conservation, I will be presenting from nowhere and you will not be able to connect the issues actually.
Yes, yes.
So I don't know, this is a quite complex issue, and I try to summarize the gist of it. The basic idea is to, like, you know, draw your attention to some of these social issues exist. It is a reality. And any mm-hmm. conservation effort, whatever it may be, whether it's a co-management or participatory management or top-to-down approach, anything, mm-hmm. it is going to be incomplete and without much success if you don't understand the social and cultural context and the economic aspect. So at least, you know, three of them, it's very important. When it mm-hmm. the economics is involved, people are, you know, people are made to suffer losses due to conservation. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many of us would come forward for the conservation as such. So we are interested in our own welfare first and then about the animal welfare, normal circumstances. So how, if economic activities are getting affected due to conservation, how we are going to resolve these issues, whether any compensation kind of mechanism alone is effect. I'll tell you one example, like if you go for compensation mechanism, what are the kind of complexities involved even in that? Yeah. Suppose elephants are raiding the crops and, you know, in one night it can finish off the entire crop.
Yes.
And people maybe whatever drums or crackers or anything they will be using, once the crop is finished, the farmers or the people who are living in the periphery, they will not be interested for conservation actually, because they think that elephant is a threat, that the best strategy is to retaliate and kill them or, you know, finish them off. The other policy the government, you know, the local government can adopt is to make the farmers more accommodative of this, you know, you change the perception of them slightly, you know, how we can change them. One is like you provide some economic incentives or the compensation. Suppose you are saying that, please don't harm the elephants. If your crop is getting damaged, we are going to compensate you for the losses of your crops. Hmm. Suppose some kind of assurance is given to them. You may think that it will work. It will work initially, but it will not work in the long term. Why? Because the farmers have no incentive to, they have actually perverse incentive. Like they will have more incentive to show that the animals have come and destroyed their life and their assets, all the assets and crops and everything, and to make wrong claims, false claims. So then there will be, suppose you imagine there are different kinds of farmers or different kinds of households living in the periphery. Some of the household may be owning maybe 10 cents or 5 cents of land and they have a small farm and they will be depending on that and then forest for their livelihood. And then there will be large farmers, you know, 2 acres, 3 acres or more than that. In the Kerala context, if it is 1 or 2 acres itself, it will be a large one. So they will be also growing the crops. So the question comes whether we can treat the small farmer and the large farmer equally, whether the compensation given will be the same amount of compensation is sufficient or even justifiable. What do you think about that? So, and the farmers, they also will have a kind of, the farmers as human beings, they will have a kind of behavior that they will try to distort the facts and figures and then claim more compensation. Even if they have not cultivated also, they will try to show that, okay, the elephant has come and destroyed so much of area. Or they might have already harvested and then say that, like, so these are kind of possible situations that will emerge in the field. So even in theoretical sense, the compensation is an effective tool to control these kinds of behavior. There are also problems of, you know, moral hazards and other problems are involved in that. So it is very difficult to propose these tools or instruments as a long-term solution for the kind of problems we are discussing now. So then what are the alternatives we can involve? So that is how a lot of thinking and the cultural context and, you know, real situation we have to assess and then come up with a mix of, you know, policies and measures. So no one kind of solution will be applicable and successful in such kind of situations.
See, the participatory approach which Gina was mentioning now, participatory approach has been developed based on social science, and that is considered to be the best method for reducing the conflict. They don't say zero level, reducing the conflict all over Africa. They are now trained in most of the, say, Namibia. I saw just yesterday, I saw a paper. Namibia has been trained successfully on that. And we have been advocating that with other people also. Otherwise, even if you go with a conflict mitigation technique, if the people are not owning the mechanism, or ownership, it should be there with the people. So that is the most important part of it. And again, attitude. I think I'll tell you a very interesting thing. Attitude depends not only on the people. It also depends on their love for certain animals. Say, while working in LRK, one of the questions asked to the people was that, you know, how do you consider, what's your tolerance level for budukar? That means, you know, the wild ass. And the reply was, oh, budukar is a very, very poor guy. You know, he doesn't have anything, you know, so I can tolerate up to 40% loss of to my crop. What about wild boar? That is wild pig. So that's a difference. So that's a difference. So the attitude, a study on attitude of the people, a study and the social acceptability of the people, of the method which you are planning. So all these are connected. So that is where I said, you know, this is very, very crucial. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am, there are many kind words in the chat box thanking you for the session, for the very informative session. There is another one question, one that has definitely opened many eyes today, about the future studies that people can take up. One engineering student graduate wants to know how he can direct his career towards conservation, biodiversity conservation and research. So if you can guide, it will be good, I guess.
Yeah, basically, you know, we have many of our colleagues from the engineering background doing wonderful studies on environmental conservation. So you definitely have some advantages when it comes to the modeling the ecological and economic impact. That relationship you can very well, but I think, you know, what engineering background you have. So maybe we can discuss this, and it is possible, and there are many successful people working in this area of conservation from the engineering background, systems ecology and all that. There are several people working. So I think I don't know who asked this question, but I can definitely, you know, discuss more on this with him.
We can ask them to contact you. Ma'am, there is one Shravan Shivakumar who wants to ask a question. So I think I can ask him to unmute and ask the question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thank you, madam. And it was a fantastic session, and it was throwing a very good light about the socio-economic impacts of conservation. Regarding the previous discussion, what we were talking about, the human-animal conflict in wildlife areas, I would like to come and see the human-animal wildlife conflict has been recorded even in the ancient literatures, and it had been on very long time. It is not such anything new that it came in last 50 years or 100 years like that. One thing what I have observed in this human-animal conflict is the farmers or the people or the society that is near the wildlife area, they want to do agriculture and they want to make the biggest profitable agriculture only. Nobody can deny it. Every farmer has every right to do it. But in a wildlife area or adjoining a wildlife area, you'll have to see what is attracting the wildlife to come and raid his crop or anything. So maybe I think they can utilize a non-palatable crop, and the compensation for the damage like that could be given to that farmer for doing a non-palatable crop or something like that. That is what I think, madam. And how do you feel about that kind of an situation, madam? I just want to have your views on that, because now when there is a damage, they are giving it. Okay, in some places where I have visited, adjoining to the forest area, the farmer will be cultivating a banana plantation, and of course the elephant will come and they will damage only. And if they do a non-palatable crop cultivation, then he must be encouraged to do that, and the compensatory mechanism should be worked on that also. I feel like that, and I would like to have your comment on that.
Yeah, that's a good observation. So as I said, like the human animal conflict is not a recent one. In the evolution of human history itself, they have always interacted with animals. Humans have always interacted with animals, and it is the domestication of animals also happened as a part of the interactions. In the process, some animals also got extinct, like they killed them in large numbers and they got extinct. But that is one part of our history actually. And coming to the human wildlife conflict, see, there are two issues here. One is, like, you know, if you are thinking in terms of wild animals coming out and raiding the crops, we have to think about what are the push and pull factors. What are the factors, you know, pushing the animals out of the forest to come outside of the forest and eat that? So that I call it as a push factor. And the animals are being pushed out from the forest by some reason. So what are the reasons? Is it lack of food inside the forest, or is it due to a large number of the population growing enormously inside the forest for, and they have to compete themselves for food and water? We have to find out. And then there are pull factors. You know, what is pulling the driving the animals to these fields? That is where what you said, like, you know, whether it is a palatable crop or non-palatable crop. Suppose there is a situation that the inside the forest they are short of foods. So definitely, like, you know, they will be coming out in search of food and water to the periphery or wherever they can go. So it is a combination of, kind of, you know, what is the situation in the forest? The quality of the forest is so poor and they can't find food. And even if we are growing non-palatable crops, still we are not solving the issues actually. So the animals will be, instead of coming to this part of the land, they will be going in search of another place. So you are only, you know, relocating the location actually. So one need to properly understand what is it that drives the animals out of forest, and what are the invitations they get from the periphery, and then decide what is best for them. Because unless and until they have food and water, it's bound to come out in search of that. So that is what I will say, that the context you have to be clearly understood, whether it is the outside factors, you know, alone. Suppose the forest has plenty of food and still the people are cultivating crops that are very that are of interest to the animals, then we have to, like, you know, educate the farmers and say that you cannot grow these crops. If you are growing these crops and inviting the animals here, and then animals are raiding the crops, we are not going to compensate you. That could be one stand. And then you advise that these are the other kinds of crops that can be grown here. And if you grow these crops and still the animals comes and, you know, raid your crops, we will give you some kind of compensation. So we have to not judge the behavior and behavior of the animals as well as the humans, and then decide the cropping pattern. It is basically resource use conflict. Actually, the farmers, as you rightly said, they want to get maximum benefit out of the little land they have. So they will be growing high value crops, and those high value crops also may be palatable for the wildlife. So that is where, you know, the other option is, you know, if the farmers can be, if the people living in the peripheral areas, if they can be diverted from growing, engaged in agriculture instead of some other livelihood activities also. So it is not only that the crops are coming here, the people also will be going inside the forest and disturbing the animals. So if we have to have a successful strategy for conservation, we also have to focus on the livelihood aspects of the humans living in and around the areas. So livelihood diversification also in a great way helped to reduce these kinds of conflicts. That's what I feel.
Okay, madam, thank you. And actually, even in places when you see when there is an abundance of food and the resources available for the wildlife inside the protected area, the behavioral change of these animals are so great now due to the lot of linear intrusions, and there are a lot of degrading factors inside the forest also. But when you very keenly observe, the behavioral change has made the animal into more of crop raiding and damage to livelihoods of people on the adjacent areas. For example, if you see when you closely observe, there are a set of elephants. When you're talking about elephants, the elephants that are depending only on food inside the forest, they have a moderate physique, and the elephant team that totally raids the crop, you find them very healthy, and they are used to that kind of food, whatever the kind of food is available inside the forest also. When there is some attraction, that is the push, pull and push factor that you have been explaining, and there is something attracting, and they will come only to take it because of the behavioral degradation that has happened. So it's a win-win situation only. Thank you for your response.
Thank you.
Ma'am, there is another question asking if you could elaborate on the importance of conservation from an ethical angle.
Ethical angle, okay. See, there are two parties involved here actually. One is animal and one is human. Okay, so both have rights to live on this planet. So how do we decide, you know, whether we can have only humans or we cannot have animals here? Humans have more rights to live on this planet than animals. So that is a very challenging question actually. Mm-hmm. So there are human rights perspectives. So suppose, you know, that is why there are two groups of people arguing, one stands for the animal rights, because animal rights often is not enough represented in our policy decisions and policy making, whereas human rights are always, you know, come to the prominence, or they dominate. So that is why we have to think about the animal rights also. So there is a lot of, you know, talk and dialogue going on for the protection of animal rights itself. But then there are also human rights. So one of the solutions, you know, managing the conflict with the wildlife is the killing of the animals. Many places it is adopted. But then the question is whether it is ethically right to do so. So sometimes, you know, what happens is the species, maybe they are in large number and we have engaged in the killing of it. Finally, it may also lead to extinction. I don't remember the names of the animals, but there are cases from US and other countries which say that because of this killing of animals, some species have already gone extinct. Yes, so yes. Do we have an ethical right to do that? And then the other question is to protect the animals, whether we can make the humans suffer, because there are several people who are on the verge of poverty or were in poverty and, you know, have meager livelihoods. they have to suffer all the losses and there is no human right for them. So it is a very contentious kind of issues. The idea is to strike a balance between both animal rights and human rights as far as possible. The extreme measures of killing and other things must be avoided. And at the same time, we have to protect the livelihoods and life of the people. So that is a fine balance, actually. And how we design the programs, that is our challenge, actually. So ethically, you know, both humans and animals must be protected.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, there is actually another question, quite heartening to see how students can get into conservation activities. So you have definitely inspired a few people today.
Okay. So I think in a conservation activities, engaging in direct conservation activities, probably Dr. Risa is the right person to give you directions to the various kinds of avenues available. And for me, you know, it is in the mostly in the field of academic activities and research that I try to explain certain phenomena and try to influence policy and other things. I think I'll pass it on to Dr. Risa to
see, the engaging or getting involved in conservation issues actually depends on the area. It depends on the region. See, first of all, as Gina was mentioning, you know, you have to identify the issues. What are the issues and what could be the solution? So the first thing is to look around and see what are the issues and what could be the solutions. And if you identify the solutions, you know, how could it be implemented? Okay, I think, you know, that's the most important thing. Say, for example, from Assam, there were people who had been asking questions. There is an organization called Aranyak, which is very actively involved in Assam. So, and the major issues are definitely the human wildlife conflict, and he was also mentioning about some of the birds, and, you know, you have the dolphins there. So there are issues. So how to address that? And there may be, maybe some solution is also has to come from working with the people. That is also crucial. You can also think of working with the people in the affected areas. So that's also a possibility. And somebody was mentioning about the, so, and again, the perspectives differ because, you know, do you consider a conflict, a leopard conflict as an issue? I mean, it need not be. But some others definitely feel that, you know, it is a major issue. So it depends. So I think, you know, the first thing is to identify the conservation issues in your region and then get in touch with the people who are already working on that particular aspect, or you have to go for organizing the youngsters or others, you know, from that field. And I think, you know, the first thing is to definitely identify the issues in that area and then formulate a strategy. Maybe with consultation with others, and then go for actions. And for actions, definitely you need support. Financial support is there, and you know, so many things are required. But that is mobilization of resources for working. That is the other part of it. So I think, you know, that's the most important thing. I think the other question about engineering graduate, Gina has wonderfully explained, and I didn't know that, you know, somebody has been working on social aspects of conservation. From the engineering league. But there are, there is an institution called NCBS, National Center for Biodiversity Studies in Bangalore. About 70% of those who get into that course, MS Wildlife course in that organization, are engineers. So that's it. So if you have that attitude, and if you have that sort of approach, definitely there are options. A lot of options are there. But it doesn't mean that, you know, you'll get a government job immediately or you'll get into something. No, conservation is sometimes not that rewarding financially. That is also important.
Thank you, sir. That was very encouraging. Ma'am, there is one more question. Don't you think that population climate control strategies are the need of the hour for long-term success of any conservation activity? How can a country ensure that?
Yeah, this is so something which I did not touch upon, actually, the climate change aspect. Population growth is, of course, you know, population is a population problem. You know, what it leads to is to the resource use conflicts. That is a major reason, like, you know, why all the conflicts emerge, because we have limited amount of natural resources and people and animals have to compete for those limited resources. So unless and until the population pressure is reduced on the natural resources, these problems can happen. But it is not that the growth in the population per se that is causing a problem here in the context of natural resources. It is the extent of dependence on the resources and the extraction. Dependence means don't mistake that it is only for livelihoods, the existence or the survival of the people. But large tracts of forest land and the natural resources have been gone for other kind of development purposes, the so-called development purposes, and where large tracts of natural resources have been converted. So that is a conflict here emerging. It is not just livelihood, it is a big business interest that is also coming in way of resources. So it is not the population pressure alone, but we can call it as a large as the developmental pressure. And developmental pressure, which is, we call it as, you know, not a green development. You know, we are focusing on the growth, economic growth per se, and that even the pursuit of economic growth is going to is creating all these kinds of problems. But already there has been a change in the mindset and also the policy level measures that we cannot go with this kind of growth, that so-called economic growth we have been pursuing all through. But we have to amend our ways and make, you know, natural resources more, you know, sustainable use of natural resources. So I don't think, you know, the population per se is a problem, but the changes happening to the lifestyle, the changes happening to the other, you know, economic activities that is causing more harm than the population per se. And these are all causing changes to climate. Climate change is due to various reasons. Climate is changing, and the changing climate is also definitely going to impact on very many kinds of, you know, wild animals and resources, not only the terrestrial animals, but also the oceanic and water animals, etc. So the way we develop is more important, and the way we do things are more important than population pressure as such. That's my view.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question is there. Is there any project in India for increasing awareness amongst farmers about human-animal conflict?
I think there are many efforts going on to create this awareness. In many local areas, local panchayats are all engaged in this creating awareness. So different kinds of programs are implemented at different levels actually. So generally the awareness creation is happening, but I don't know whether to what extent it is impacting. I have not come across any studies that have really assessed the impact of such things. Because I also don't know work in the area of human life, animal conflict, so I'm not the right person to comment on that.
Sir has also added that there are many awareness programs in different places.
There are so many awareness programs. Say, for example, one of the issues, I think, you know, this is again connected to livelihood. Anything which doesn't ensure the livelihood and the life, food security of the people, no conservation will work. That is the most important part of it. So to ensure. People always say that, you know, okay, well, this is these people are inside the forest, so they should suffer. No, you cannot. You also have to consider. I thought Gina would have probably mentioned, you know, I was just out for some time. That is, you know, there is a contribution, a silent contribution by these people for conservation. So that is not taken into account in any of the economical evaluation. That is not considered. Say I cannot a person sitting in or staying in the middle of the forest, he may not be going out for a film in the evening. No, he cannot come back. He can go, but he cannot come back because, you know, he's worried about the wildlife around, and he cannot send her, his students, his children for better education, maybe a tuition in the evening. No, they don't have any freedom to move around in the evening. So a lot of suffering, and I call it as a lot of contribution. So you can call it as a sacrifice. So these things also have to be taken into account. And when you talk about livelihood, there was a program in central India mostly, but southern India, that's a dancing bear issue was there. So a community called a Kalandar, they had been using a bear for dancing, and then they sell the hair. And even in Kerala, they used to bring a bear. And, you know, a lot of our people have gone and purchased the hair of that, you know, thinking that it will help them to escape from the fear of anything. So likewise. So, but then came the problem. Okay, you can go and confiscate these animals. That is only one part of it. Then what will these people do? They will go back and again capture from Chhattisgarh or Madhya Pradesh. They go to even to the bear den and then capture it. So there was an issue. So what happened? They were given alternate livelihood. It was a successful program. Unless and until you ensure alternate livelihood, or unless and until you ensure livelihood to the people, affected people, you cannot expect any support for conservation. So that is where the social science comes. You have to understand their lifestyle and their requirement, and also there's a situation, their social acceptability. So all these things will definitely help planning. That is where that's why I said, you know, the eco-development, about which, you know, Sanjay will be talking later. That is definitely an offshoot from the social science participation in the whole thing. A lot of awareness programs are organized by NGOs, by government departments, and Wildlife Week is only one part of it. Even otherwise, you know, a lot of nature camps, you know, by organized by the forest department in Kerala. Unfortunately, in other states, I have never seen nature camps. But here, nature camps are there. It's an awareness program. So among the farmers, for farmers also, they are organizing. And in other places, also, the affected, a lot of people go to the, in Wayanad, I know that, you know, Wayanad Prakriti Samrakshana Samiti, they also organize. And, you know, there are several such NGOs working for that. Definitely, there is a scope for organizing it in your own place also.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. And thank you, ma'am. If there are no more questions, yes, there is another post. Conservation begins at home. Yes, it does. Definitely does, Naveen. So if there are no more questions, I think I'll take this opportunity to thank ma'am for taking her time and putting in the effort to explain to us in such simple terms what conservation really is. Conservation, everyone is getting on the bandwagon these days, including half the participants today probably, but we never knew that conservation in essentially means an integration of the natural and social sciences. For us, it was just a natural aspect of it, just saving the animals and the plants. But then the social science aspect of it, you have definitely cleared it up for us, ma'am. And I am glad that it has started a conversation. And I would also like to thank Isa sir for his enthusiastic participation. I would like to take this moment to remind everyone that sir is coming tomorrow with us on another seminar, Into the Life of Gentle Giants. You should definitely join in to listen to more of what he has to say. So as a vote of thanks, ma'am, thank you so much once again for your words.
Thanks, Gina, for making it simple, because, you know, normally whenever these economists and social scientists speak, you know, they come with a lot of modeling and several things, you know, which will put all of us in trouble. But she has tried her level best to make it simpler. So that's great.
We were definitely worried how much we would be able to grasp from this, but definitely it has started a conversation, and we know where to go forward from here. Definitely our activities will involve more studies. We'll start understanding the problems in our society first, because understanding the problem is where it all begins. And I would also like to thank all the participants who have participated so enthusiastically in this. It is your support that makes us work harder and bring more webinars to you. Thank you so much. And last but not the least, I would also like to thank all the members of Aranyakam Nature Society and Green Pixels for their untiring efforts towards making this endeavor a success. Thank you, everyone. See you tomorrow at 7 p.m. Meanwhile, you can find us on Instagram and Facebook. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.